Good morning again. I want to welcome you to the service for Harry Barr as we remember and as we celebrate the life he lived, the life that he shared. So today we gather here with family and friends who are in person as well as those joining us on live stream. We thank you for being here this morning as we gather to celebrate this life. So we do that. We're here to begin with a few words from Harry's son, JB, as he shares some memories of his father.
Good morning, everyone. I know you all knew my father very well, and so I don't need to tell you what a great pilot he was. I don't need to tell you what a great, generous mentor he was to so many people, and I don't need to tell you what a great friend he was. He was all those things and more. What I'd like to do is just share with you a few memories, a few personal reflections that might help you all to know what he was to me. When I went off to college in my first semester, I learned about this concept called rugged individualism. This was a term that was used by Herbert Hoover to describe people who were Americans who were very individualistic and independent and self-reliant. And when I read about that concept in my textbook, I wasn't too surprised to find a picture of Harry Barr in that textbook. I think he definitely was the ideal person for that notion. When I think about rugged individualism and my father, I think about him in Alaska flying Argosies and flying sky vans and helicopters. And I think about him helping to set up Minuteman missile sites across the Great Plains. He was the kind of person to take on those endeavors that most people never thought of doing. The four grandsons are here, Noah, Harrison, Luke, and Drew. And they became very aware of many papa-isms, they used to call them. And one of the most important ones was, don't do nothing dumb. And I suspect many of us heard that from my dad's mouth at one time or another. And unfortunately, I think I personally violated that edict several times, at least. And one that I remember well was when I was a little kid, and we used to fly over to the family farm in Clarinda many Sundays. And there was one particular Sunday where my cousin Pam and I, who together we got into plenty of mischief when we were little, but one particular day we were playing in the bathroom and I was trying to walk around the perimeter of the bathtub for some reason. And I thought that was a cool thing to do, but I slipped and fell and I broke my arm pretty badly. And he had to pack us all up in his little Yankee and fly us back to Lincoln as quickly as he could. And we got there and got to the hospital, and the orthopedist there gave Dad two choices, two options. You could either, he could either set the bone back into place quickly, you know, with one quick movement and no anesthesia or anything, and be done with it. That's the more painful way. Or you could take some time, you know, do the anesthesia, and then reset the bone a little more comfortably. Guess which one Dad took? I've mostly blocked that memory from my conscious thought. There's another saying that a lot of people know, and I don't really remember my dad saying it, but he lived it. It was called, it's better to ask for forgiveness than to ask for permission. I don't think anybody lived that more than Harry Barr. So one particular memory of that I have is Julie and I and my dad went up in the helicopter and we were going to scatter my mom's ashes over the Platte River. And we got about halfway there and realized that the ashes were in the storage compartment that you couldn't get to in flight. So he had to land somewhere so that we could retrieve the ashes. And he picked out a nice looking baseball field that didn't have anybody around that we could see and wasn't being used and everything. So he put it down there, and immediately a groundskeeper comes running out, looking fairly angry, unhappy that maybe we were going to mess up his well-groomed field. And Julie and I are sitting there, and we're kind of freaking out. Oh, no, we're in trouble now. And Dad just calmly gets out, retrieves the ashes, goes back, gets ready to take off. And, you know, the angry man is saying something to us that thankfully we couldn't understand. And he just said, "You better get out of the way, because here we go." And took off, went about our way, and never heard about it again, thankfully. One of the things that I really admired about my dad and that I think typifies who he was is he was unafraid. He was unafraid to do the things that he really wanted to do, unafraid to do the things, to pursue things that many, many times maybe people would hold themselves back from, but he didn't have that kind of a spirit or attitude. He had an attitude of optimism that he could do whatever he wanted to do, and confidence that he could get those things done. And I think that everybody who was around him and knew him, some of that optimism and confidence rubbed off on all of us, I think. And I'm very thankful and grateful for that. You know, my dad, when I was a kid, he was a larger-than-life kind of a figure, you know? I think he was that for a lot of us. And he, you know, he could do anything in an airplane, and he could do almost anything on the ground, too. So that's the way that I'll choose to remember him. And one of the things that helped me get through everything, when he became ill and it was becoming obvious that he wasn't going to be on this earth too much longer, was to think about the reunion that he's had with my mom and my sister. I continue to think of them waiting there for him in heaven and welcoming him home. And that's what gives me comfort now. So finally, I want to leave you with this. I don't know what the future holds for any of us, for me, for all of you, for the grandsons, but I do know this, that Dad always said, one of his favorite sayings was, indecision is the key to flexibility. Thank you very much.
His faithfulness, your shield. And we continue the remembrance of baptism, and we read responsibly. In early baptism, Harry was clothed the robe of Christ's righteousness that covered all his sin. St. Paul says, "Do you not know that all of us were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death?
We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his." We begin as we gather this morning, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the source of life and peace. Amen. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrow with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. Thanks be to God. Amen. This time we profess the faith that was Harry's. We do this in the ancient words of the Apostles' Creed. I invite you to speak these words together with me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our first scripture reading from Isaiah chapter 40. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary, and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. This is the word of our Lord.
Be afraid nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness, for his name's sake.
May the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you.
Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
For I consider that sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Our next scripture lesson comes from John chapter 14. Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" And Jesus answered, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." This is the gospel of our Lord.
We pray. Holy God, we give you thanks and praise for the gift of this day, for the gift of life that you gave to Harry, this gift of life, Lord, that we celebrate this day. Bless those who are gathered here, and those who are gathered through live stream, for all who mourn the death of Harry as one that was dearly loved, as a grandfather, a father, a brother, a friend. We pray this, Jesus, in your name. Amen. The year 1954. Some of you that are gathered here today in person live stream may remember something about that year.
Others of you, that is something that is in the history books. And for Harry, 1954 was a year that shaped his life. There in Clarinda, Iowa, his cousin, if you know this story, Todd Barr, brought home this new 1954 Super Cub and took Harry for a flight. And from that moment on, Harry was hooked. He loved aviation, and that shaped his life. That same year, he learned how to fly, took out a loan from his dad so that he could buy his first airplane. Following year, he moved to Omaha and began working at Lang Aircraft and build this relationship with Donald Duncan, of course, now part of Duncan Aviation and the longest probably pilot they've ever had there. I mean, this shaped Harry's life, this love of aviation. And as J.B. shared some of those stories, that shaping of his life and the places that he had been, the many years that he spent in Alaska, you know, flying those power poles, working with the Bureau of Land Management for about 24 years, you know, connected to the Alaska pipeline up there and the work that he did. And probably, though, more than anything from Alaska, at least in the years that I knew Harry, was that he got to spend time with his grandsons. And that's what he would say. I remember a few times, he's like, "I'll see you in a few weeks, Pastor. I'm going to Alaska." And I asked, he told me the whole story, but what was so cherished for him was that he was spending time with his grandsons and sharing not only his love of aviation, but his love of life. And as you said, JB, that love of life he had, he just loved to live it boldly. Yet a man who lived life boldly, but a man who was known for being kind, and gentle, and always there to help. And I was kind of sitting there as you were talking to and glancing at what folks were posting on Facebook, and a lot of them kind and gentle, and a guy that was always there for you, a guy that just really shared his love with you. All this just shaped who he was. I mean, Harry was a world traveler. Some of us haven't traveled much beyond Nebraska, and Harry, you know, through his experience and his flying, traveled all over the world. Met people from all over the world. He has a great list of accomplishments, things that he did, from his humanitarian missions to the mentoring of young pilots to being a member of the Nebraska Aviation Hall of Fame. You know, his work with Gary Teach at Mission Central and flying Gary around, and his involvement with the mission work of the church. You know, he's long list of accomplishments that you could go on and on about of who Harry was. And you see that one moment in 1954 had shaped Harry's life. And it shaped our lives as we interacted with Harry. And those who especially you knew Harry as a father and a grandfather, as a friend and a co-worker, he is someone that shared that life and the joy of life with you. You know, and life, with all the list of accomplishments that Harry could have, there were those moments of celebration that we have, that Harry could have. Those moments of celebrating what life had to offer. There was also moments of defeat and despair. And from the time that he lost his wife, much earlier than expected, to the tragic loss of his daughter. Those moments of celebration and defeat. And those two were what shape our lives. So the question for you just to ponder as we go through here is what's shaping your life? What's shaping your life? Obviously, Harry helped shape your life, or you wouldn't be here this morning. And whether that is because you grew up with him, again, you knew him as dad or as you know, Papa, or whether you worked with him in Dunk Aviation, whether you know him as a family or a friend, however your connection is, you know, he helped shape your life. What shaped Harry's life? Well, a love of aviation most definitely shaped Harry's life. The guy who, you know, I saw that picture, which reminded me of the story that he told, you know, had the smallest Midwest airport as they landed on this vehicle. I was just trying to scratch my head what that looked like when he told me that story. You know, a guy that had all kinds of great adventures. But what shaped his life, I think, is reflected a lot in some of the other words that I would hear him say often. You know, because Harry usually sat right about over there and was here a little early, so would always, you know, have a little chat with Harry. That's where he hears some of these great stories. It's, Harry, how you doing this morning? And if you've ever asked him this question or something similar, you know what he says, right? Can you say it with me? Better than I deserve, right? Better than I deserve. Now, I think Harry said that because it was more than just some kind of catchphrase. I think it's because of what shaped Harry's life. Even more than his love of aviation, and his love of adventure, and his love of his family and his friends. What really shaped his life was that he knew that everything that he had, for all of his accomplishments, for all of his celebrations, for all of his defeats and his despair in life, is that what he had was better than he deserved. Because he understood God's love for him. He understood that what he deserved, because even though he allotted great accomplishments, what he deserved was not what he was getting. Especially when it came to his relationship with God. And these words here in Psalm 103, verses 10 and 11 reflect that saying of Harry's, better than I deserve. And I invite you, if you'd like to, we can read these words together. It'd be two screens here. He has not treated us as we deserve for our sins, or paid us back for our wrongs. As high as the heavens are above the earth, that is as vast as mercy is towards those who fear him. Better than I deserve. As high as the heavens are above the earth. I mean, that just speaks well for a guy who loved to fly. The guy who understood God's grace and God's love for him. That Harry understood that God created him. God created all of us to be in a relationship with him. But our sins separate us from that relationship. And, you know, those of you who really knew Harry might have some areas in his life where he was maybe not the proudest of. You might have other stories to share or stories that you won't share. But Harry knew that his sin separated him from God. He knew that even though he could list a lot of great accomplishments in life, that did not get him his standing with God. What he got was better than what he deserved. His sin separated him. Our sins separate us from God. And that there's no list of accomplishments that we can have, no matter how kind or gentle, no matter how adventurous, no matter how many times maybe you do a humanitarian act, that is not what gives us what we get from God. Because we don't get what we deserve. Instead, we get what we're offered in Jesus Christ. And Harry knew this and believe this, and this shaped his life. But his sins, while they separated him from God, his sins could not be removed by his accomplishments and all the things that he may have been proud of in his life. His sins removed by what Jesus did for him at the cross and what Jesus does for each and every one of us. That's where God removes our sins away from us. That's how vast God's mercy, his love is. And the word mercy is a judicial term. Mercy means not getting what we deserve. That instead, the one that gets what we deserve is God's Son, Jesus Christ. The one who suffered and died on the cross and rose again. Harry believed this, and this shaped his life. It shaped his understanding of himself and the life around him. He knew that he had life with God because of God, and that he had life for all eternity. That's why a few weeks ago, and I'm so glad, you know, that a number of folks called the church office and said, hey, do you guys know that Harry's not doing well? And the conversation I had with Harry and called him up, and how are you doing, Harry? Not good. He was talked about being in a lot of pain. He had some tests coming up, but he kind of already knew what the tests were going to say. And there he already began saying, I know where I'm going. He knew what he deserved because of his sins. We know what we deserve because of our sins. But Harry also knew that because of Jesus, what was his? Life, love, mercy, and grace from God. And that what Harry now celebrates and now lives is a life with God for all eternity. And yes, you know, with a wife that he loved, with a daughter that he loved, and all those who've gone before. You'd ask Harry that question, how you doing? He'd say, what? Better than I deserve. Harry's life is a life that is shaped by God's love. Better than any of us deserve. But a love he freely gives to us, a love he freely gave to Harry and Jesus Christ. So today as we gather here, we gather and we celebrate the life that he lived and the life that he shared. And we laugh and we cry and, you know, we relive all of those parts of this life that we had together with him. But we also celebrate the life that is his today and for all eternity in Jesus Christ. A life better than what he or you and I deserve. But a life that is ours and a life that is yours in Jesus. Amen. Continue now as we pray and invite you, these prayers are responsive so we can respond with these prayers. Let us pray. Almighty God, today our hearts bear the sadness of parting and grief. Yet the wonder of your love and overcoming death leads us to praise and thanksgiving. Thank you for the promise of life that transcends our earthly existence. Hear us, O Lord. Give courage and faith to Harry's loved ones, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the assurance of a holy and certain hope, in the communion of your church, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with all those they love who have departed in the faith. Hear us, O Lord. Grant us grace to entrust Harry to your never-failing love, that our hearts and lives, while remembering him in love and cherishing his memory, may be healed from our grief. Hear us, O Lord. God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light through the gospel. We give you thanks that by his death he has destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection he has opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Give us that certain faith that because he lives, we who live in faith shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. At this time, we continue as we pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now receive the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
The splendor of a king. in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? All will see how great is our God. Age to age he stands. Time is in his hands. Beginning and the end. Beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one. Father, Spirit, Son. The Lion and the Lamb. The Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And I will see.
I want to thank you again for being here this morning as we, again, remember and celebrate Harry's life, especially being here for the family and friends, for those joining on live stream during these unusual times. We celebrate this life that Harry lived, the life that he shared, the love and passion that he shared, especially in Jesus Christ. God's richest blessings be with you as you go about the rest of your day. God's peace. So for those of you who are here, again, we thank you for being here in